is God. To me, God is not just the idols that you see in the temples. God is not confined to all these pictures and idols and things. They are symbolic of that totality consciousness which is all pervasive. If there is energy, if you can take the totality of the energy, that's God. If you say there is intelligence, well, all the intelligence of the universe put together and beyond, that will be God. Anything in its totality is God, because in its totality it is whole. It's not in part, but all this part make that whole. But that whole is the ultimate holiness.
So now, if in Hindu terminology, because you have given your discourse in Hinduism, you know, you are a specialist in that. So if I ask you that God, we say Brahma, Vishnu, Brahma, Shiva, Brahma and Vishnu, we give three formats. So is that God?
Absolutely. In our Hindu philosophy, we look at it, Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, they are having different, you know, kind of responsibilities to perform, you know, to keep this cosmic balance.
Brahma, Vishnu,
Maheshwara. Because why? Because you say Brahma is the one who is the creator. Vishnu is the one who is the sustainer. Because anything that you create needs to be sustained, isn't it? Anything that you create needs to be sustained. If you buy an apartment to live, that apartment needs to be taken care so that the apartment sustained for a particular period of time. So anything that is created needs to be sustained. So if there is a Brahma, there has to be Vishnu. Who is Vishnu? Vishnu is that force, that power, that energy, that intelligence, which basically brings the balance in this whole universe so that the universe can sustain it, live and continue. But that is not the only thing, because in Hindu philosophy, the entire concept of this time and creation and preservation doesn't end there, because it goes to the third phase of annihilation or destruction.
Shiva.
That is Shiva aspect. What is that? Shiva as a destroyer. Now it's destroyed. The moment you hear the word destroyer, it's like something very negative. It's not that. Imagine if I as an individual, I start my journey. If I as an individual is created as a body, this is Brahma. I'm created as a human body. So Brahma must have done it. Okay? Now I am being sustained for 80 years. So somebody is taking care of me, sustaining me so that I can be alive. This is a Vishnu aspect. But then a time is going to come when this body will go. Because anything that is created will be destroyed at the end. Anything that is born has to die and decay at times, because that's the process. But then there is a subtle aspect of it. The subtle aspect is, Shiva is not just the destroyer of the things that you see in a material perception. Shiva is the destroyer of your ego too. Then you are born into a higher consciousness where you see you are not an individual just with a body limitations, mind limitation, intelligence limited. With your limited spares, you live. But as you grow in meditation and practice of worship and spirituality or religion, then gradually you grow into a dimension wherein your ego, with which you move in a material world, it gets glory and glory, subtle. It becomes very subtle. You expand. So you are not so much selfish as previously. So you'll become a little more selfless, and you start to, you know, give yourself, love others, spread yourself and reach out to those people who are in pain, agony, sufferings. So all of it is happening. So your ego, which was previously thinking of yourself and your family and your little thing, now is expanded. This expanded version of ego would gradually take you to a higher level of life. And that higher level of life, there is ego, but it's a very subtle ego, refined ego. And that subtle, refined ego is a sadhaks or a yogis. But that ego also will go to a particular place where that ego will be totally surrendered to the divine. Like Meera singing to Krishna, the time has come when the Meera as an individual is merged into Krishna, the totality. So the whole process is how you start the journey from individuality to universality, from your selfish little self to the selfless expansion of the universe. So it's like a journey from asat to sat, from darkness to light, from that which is untruth to truth, and finally from death to immortality. To take you to the immortality, you need the Shiva, you need the Vishnu, you need the trilogy of this Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara. But then we also have the concept of Parabrahma. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo, Maheshwara, Guru Shakshat Parabrahma. There's another concept is coming. We are not stopping at Shiva. We are also telling Guru is Brahma, Guru is Vishnu, Guru is Maheshwara. And then we are saying Guru Shakshat Parabrahma, Tashmai Shri Gurave Nama. So that means there is a Parabrahma. Beyond this trilogy, there is something straight, even higher. What is that? That is that one indivisible concept. That is, here we are talking about three, but there is one who is all the three merged together into one unity consciousness, which is the ultimate Purusha, the ultimate Purushottama, or that ultimate Godhead, or the ultimate reality, or the ultimate beyond all duality and multiplicity. That one consciousness, which is the root of all consciousness, that one which is the root of all that is created, all that is sustained, all that is ultimately merging, it is almost like an ocean is there. Waves are formed, and then waves stay, and then the waves merge into the ocean. That ocean is God, that ultimate Parabrahma. Because that ocean is an expansion which is holding everything together. But then we know the ocean by seeing the water and the waves. These are the creations that are happening all over. The totality of the intelligence, the totality of the consciousness, that's God.